Yes. Brian, there with me. In a plastic jacket, may I tell you? Yeah, man. It's like a rabbit take a touch to this tune and make it sound totally different. Why you look manic? Manic, right? Yeah, so this is a yes, Muta. Manic is a new kid on the block when it come on to cutting edge. I hope she they have it with for the next 20 years. Believe you me, I hope she they have it with for the next 20 years. Manic, I want you to sit down right or you sit down less or no, you see? And watch Brian till 2 o'clock. And you got, seriously. Because when I do that now, is when I start though, every night. I look for Alkaline, look for Vibes Cartel, and then I start to sleep. I don't know what's wrong with them two picture there, why every time I look upon them, I sleep. You know, something about the picture them. you don't say Alkaline get fat now. Eh? Alkaline get fat now. We know they're supposed to love him picture more now. Eh?
No.
You prefer him when him slim?
Never prefer
him. Then now you watch him so much on the computer. You know, say, I got through some old cutting edge tapes from a player from years ago and a catalog where a sister, you know, and Kobe. Why you look at sister there, you know, from England is the first person that I know we actually catalog the cutting edge program them. I mean like catalog them the right way and label it and everything and give me them as a package. Long time me no hear from her, long time me no talk to her. Me no know how I'm to her, which part she there, but anybody who know her, tell her say Muta Baruka yell her up. Yes, it's long time I don't see her, I hear from her. It's the first sister we actually catalog the cutting edge tape them. Put them together on a CD with label and everything and give me them when me there in England. So want to build up on Kobe, I believe you me. She really do a big work when she give me that. Because you know, say that is a archive in itself. And we see a youth that do it with the cutting edge and the stepping razor. Pan the YouTube. Anyway, them want to yell him up. I don't know how. It's more than one youth still. But I want to yell him up because most of the times, anywhere we go into the world and people say them hear the cutting edge, them always wonder if IRFM going put them up on an archives thing. But them say, I know nothing because them go up on YouTube and listen. So, why yell up them people there, you know? Believe you me, why yell them up. Okay, so, as we say, we are going through some archival tapes and we are going to do this month here, in November this, yeah, we are going to do it archival upon the cutting edge. We are going to play back some tape where we did play over the years. You understand that? You know, a whole heap of people are listening. I know we never used to listen when we are playing them thing here. But we feel like them still relevant on a whole heap of way. So, as soon as we clear out them whole heap of advertisements, yeah, we are going to go continue. Where's another advertisement? 10:30? All right, so we can just go on with some little things, little music and little things before we give you the cooks. Not even the cooks, the meat or the matter, or that them call it. A two terrible thing that you know, meat and matter. That's a terrible combination.
Hey folks, welcome to another edition of Questions Protestants Can't Answer. Today's question is, who wrote the Gospel of Mark? And how do you know? I'm John Martinoni, president and founder of the Bible Christian Society. And today's question is focused on the idea of sola scriptura, which is Latin for the Bible alone, or the Bible only, which is one of the fundamental pillars of most of Protestantism, that we can know all we need to know about our Christian faith and about Christian morals by simply picking up the Bible and reading. So this question, who wrote the book of Mark, is a very important question because what it does is if all I need to know about Christianity I get from the Bible, if the Bible is my sole authority in matters of faith and morals, which it is for most Protestants, how can they answer that question? Because nowhere in the Bible does it tell us who wrote the book of Mark. This thing right here at the beginning of the Gospel of Mark in Scripture that says the Gospel according to Mark, that's not inspired Scripture. That's put in there by the publisher of the Bible. We don't have any originals from Mark that say, I, Mark, wrote this Gospel, or that say the Gospel according to Mark. So again, if you go by the Bible alone, how do you know that Mark wrote Mark? That somebody named Mark even wrote Mark? And how do you know that that Mark was inspired? Where in the Bible does it tell you who wrote the Gospel of Mark so that you may trust that it is inspired Scripture? Because if you don't know who wrote it, how can you know it's inspired Scripture? This is very, very important. So as Catholics, we need to ask everyone who believes in the Bible alone as their sole rule of faith, who wrote Mark? And if they say Mark, the secretary of Peter and companion of Paul, the next question is, how do you know? Because I read Mark and there's nothing here that says, I, Mark, companion of Peter and Paul, wrote this gospel. Nothing in Luke that tells me, nothing in Paul's letters that tells me who wrote the Gospel of Mark. So what authority are you relying on? It's not the scriptures to know who wrote Mark. So again, the question is, who wrote the Gospel of Mark and how do you know?
I reaffirm, thought-provoking, always smoking, lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Yeah, for those of you who have been asking us, you know, I mean, when we say ask, we mean ask me, because there's no place to go all over the place and people ask me. I am told that you can get the programs on demand. So when you go to the website, yes, if you are a contributor, you pay your money and thing, you can get it on demand. So for those of you who've been asking me, and we are talking about in Africa especially, believe you be, all the country them, Nigeria, Senegal, Gambia, South Africa, we will visit this year. I mean, like, all the rats them in South Africa were asked me, on demand, that is how it go, on demand, you can get it. So if you want to listen to the Cutting Edge and the Stepping Razor, you go there and you get it on demand. Okay. We continue the journey. As we say, we got through the archives and we want to present some tape from them time. That we want to present this tape that name Money. But before we do it, as we say, is advertisement them enough? Advertisement time? Advertisement time.
Faith and about Christian morals by simply picking up the Bible and reading. So this question, who wrote the book of Mark, is a very important question, because what it does is, if all I need to know about Christianity I get from the Bible, if the Bible is my sole authority in matters of faith and morals, which it is for most Protestants, how can they answer that question? Because nowhere in the Bible does it tell us who wrote the book of Mark. This thing right here at the beginning of the Gospel of Mark in Scripture that says the Gospel according to Mark, that's not inspired Scripture. That's put in there by the publisher of the Bible. We don't have any originals from Mark that say, I, Mark, wrote this Gospel, or that say the Gospel according to Mark. So again, if you go by the Bible alone, how do you know that Mark wrote Mark? That somebody named Mark even wrote Mark? And how do you know that that Mark was inspired? Where in the Bible does it tell you who wrote the Gospel of Mark so that you may trust that it is inspired Scripture? Because if you don't know who wrote it, how can you know it's inspired Scripture? This is very, very important. So as Catholics, we need to ask everyone who believes in the Bible alone as their sole rule of faith, who wrote Mark? And if they say Mark, the secretary of Peter and companion of Paul, the next question is, how do you know? Because I read Mark and there's nothing here that says, I, Mark, companion of Peter and Paul, wrote this gospel. Nothing in Luke that tells me. Nothing in Paul's letters that tells me who wrote the gospel of Mark. So what authority are you relying on? It's not the scriptures to know who wrote Mark. So again, the question is, who wrote the gospel of Mark and how do you know?
I reaffirm. Thought-provoking. Always smoking. Lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Yeah, if you do have been asking us, you know what I mean? When we say ask me, I mean ask me. Because there's no place to go all over the place and people ask me. I am told that you can get the programs on demand. So when you go to the website, yes, if you are a contributor, you pay your money and thing, you can get it on demand. So for those of you who've been asking me, and we are talking about in Africa especially, believe you me, all the country them, Nigeria, Senegal, Gambia, South Africa, we will visit this year. All the rats them in South Africa were asked me. On demand. That is how it go. On demand. You can get it. So if you want to listen to the Cutting Edge and the Stepping Razor, you go there and you get it. On demand. Okay. We continue the journey. As we say, we got through the archives and we want to present some tape from them time. We want to present this tape that name Money. But before we do it, as we say, is advertisement them enough? Advertisement time? Advertisement time.
It's the High Profit Back. 809-4743. Then complete and retain
the very special stuff at Ruby's 150 Water Lane, Kingston, from 7 a.m.
You know what I say? May I mention the sister of England, Kobe, and I just remember say, one bridging. Have some money for me. Well, African brother have some money for me, I ain't glad that I'm supposed to send it. And Kobe, we want to say heal up. Believe you me. Anyway, them want to say heal up. You know why? You know, say, me all I remember say, you did shoot the performance from me do in a Birmingham, that place there. Yeah. And it's supposed to edit out and make it into a video. And this African man have some money for me. I'm tell him, say, all right, here what you going to do. When you get the money, you're going to send it to this daughter, through my brother named Dawit. Obviously, him not send no money, so obviously, the team still put on there and not edit. So, I have to go find the African brother there. I have to go find him. I used to say, please lock down in Ireland and there, so I don't know if I can find him. I mean, him going back to Ghana, I don't know. Maybe I'm going to Liberia. Who to tell? Okay, continue. In Jamaica. Can you believe that this tune was banned in Jamaica? What a terrible thing. Maybe the band still depend it too, you know. But I can get all I refer me in trouble, you know. I fear the bad tune there. Back to the archive. We'll go back to the archive tonight. And for the whole of this month, we are going to the archive, come draw out some tape where we did play a long time. Tell you, man, a sweet artist, you know, South African artist, you know, she just go kill off herself with drugs. Brenda Fassie, one of the biggest female artists outside her, coming out of Africa. And when we say Africa, we mean the whole continent, yes. Brenda Fassie, man, me I tell you, we love her. So we play Yuma Tequila a while ago, we're going to play next Yuma Tequila. Take some advertisement, and then come forward to this tape where we are telling about. Money, it name.
Always smoking. Lyric.
Word black Africa. Not because Africans are not black. Black is an honorable word. There's
basically wrong with it. But because it presupposes that there is a legitimate white Africa. There is no legitimate white Africa. And so somebody says black Africa, ask them, what other kind of Africa legitimately is that? You never say white Europe. And you never say wet rain. What other kind of rain is there other than wet rain?
You have African people say them descended from Africans. And I ask, when them say them descended from Africans, are they Africans? Because I know descended from African. I am African. When I look on all the descendants come, I think upon descendants of Africans as like Indian and Chinese and all them people there. I know see myself as a descendant of African. All other people descended from high. I know descended from African. I are to African. And so it go. This is the Cutting Edge. And I refer me there with you. That's a serious thing, you know, my bridge in so long as so. Anyway, okay. Make up here this little thing here and go and find the table we are talking about. Yeah? The topic is money. Simple. Simple thing, money. So here goes.
Raw power. Greece were said to be the originators of gold and silver coins. Their invention of metallic coinage was a catalyst in the commercial revolution that transformed Greek civilization during the 7th century BC. It was from these metallic coins that maritime empires were built. And as the Greek cities grew in wealth and splendor, it was an accepted fact that money stood as a force to be reckoned with.
Here at the British Museum, we've got something like 750,000 coins in our collection. It's one of the most immediate sources of contact that we have with what went on in the ancient world. You put an ancient coin in your hand, you can imagine...
originates from the false goddess Juno Monitor. She was heralded by ancient Rome as a window on the future, offering consultation and warning. Rome had begun as a city of brick, but by the age of the emperors had become a city of marble. The Romans inherited the use of money from the Greeks, and they spread it all around Europe. Money was at the forefront of Roman conquest. Its standardization meant a common ground of comparison. A way to quantify a person's value or worth. Money defines societal hierarchy. It helps unify an empire that stretched from the northern Atlantic to western Asia. When Caesar was brutally murdered on the 15th of March, 44 BC, an obituary coin forged with the faces of his slayers, Brutus and Cassius, was pressed. Rome was hungry for the spoils of war, and more it was becoming a society revolving around excess and wealth. The word crass, originating from Marcus Crassus, one of the richest and most unscrupulous Romans of his day. Rome, once a nation filled with enviable virtue and beautiful rhetoric, now had become indulgent and lazy. Wealth and the accumulation of it took precedence over everything.
In a sense, the Romans weren't meant to care about cash. They're meant, their morality says, what a man is worth is his virtue. What he can contribute to the state, and actually to be counting material goods, is seen as sordid.
The fall of Pompeii would come to be seen as one of the ultimate results of excesses of money. They worshipped Mercury, the false god of trade. Pompeii had been destroyed by the eruption of Mount Vesuvius, which had buried the city under mounds of ash. Archaeological findings revealed numerous lava-covered corpses gripping, clutching, and rushing for their wealth. Even in the final hour. Pre-industrial Rome had a booming population of 1 million, which by ancient standards is comparable to New York City today. A veritable melting pot of cultures, Rome assimilated technologies, peoples, and wealth through their relentless and ruthless conquests. The term citizen of Pax Romana was one of the noblest utterances of the day. A model copied by Pax Americana.
In ancient Rome, e pluribus unum meant exactly the same thing it means to us. They built a society where they took from many different races and creeds and nationalities, and everybody who came into their world, which was a pretty big world, became a Roman.
By the 4th century, Rome was a broken city, sacked and burnt by the Goths. The drive that had made them great had vanished. Europe had turned inward. But the money-making machine continued as the roads to riches turned eastward. Four centuries after the fall of Rome, a new power arose from the Arabian deserts. The soldiers of the seal of Prophet Muhammad came with the message of Islam. Islam, unlike any other religion, not only came embodied with the classical tenets associated with religion, but also had bound in the noble Quran the manner of economics and trade. A vast free trade zone spread from Spain to China. Ibn Battuta, one of the world's greatest explorers, would in one lifetime travel over 70,000 miles, four times further than his famous contemporary Marco Polo. Travel of this kind became more frequent in the Islamic Empire, fueled by the circulation of money, commerce, and trade. The new international currency of this splendid empire was the Islamic gold and silver dinar. The money that Ibn Battuta took with him from Spain was recognized in Africa, India, and far-reaching China. Today, a media and political veil has been drawn between Islam and the Western world, obscuring much of the beautiful and colorful history. The Middle Ages were witness to an Islamic Renaissance. Kingdoms celebrated their cosmopolitan cities, palaces of outstanding grace and grandeur embellished with stunning decoration. Trade was dictated on religious grounds, courts of business law were highly developed, derived from the noble Quran, and it is on these principles that fairness and clean trade were born. Greed and hoarding were globally despised, and a beautiful balance was established between financial and religious prosperity. Charity in the form of zakat, alms giving to the poor, allowed a nation to sustain everyone at a high standard of living. The gross class divisions between rich and poor were non-existent in this era.
Money became an important connection between the different parts of the Muslim world because Muslim money needed to be unified for tax purposes. In order to pay one's charity tax or zakat, or to pay for offenses and crimes, the value of the money had to be standardized. By doing so, these coins became accepted in all parts of the House of Islam.
The power of Islamic money was formidable, but only as strong as its source of gold. A new source would be found in Africa. By the time Ibn Battuta attempted the crossing, a gold route through the Sahara was well established. A trading post on the Trans-Sahara could expect a yearly turnover of 400,000 dinar, billions by today's standards. When enterprising Muslim mariners navigated the Indian monsoon waters around India, the merchants that followed found China in 1346. Ibn Battuta, on his travels to China, discovered the new and amazing practice of buying and selling by paper notes. Silk, spices, gunpowder, gold, paper and print now moved on a current of money, paper money.
You had coins worth virtually nothing, which were strung together in strings of 1,000 and traded that way. Somebody finally got the idea, why not just make a paper certificate and trade that?
It would be centuries before Europe would adopt the use of paper currency. Meanwhile, a revolution in mathematics was born from the Islamic universities in Cairo, Baghdad, and Fez. Islamic scientists had perfected algebra, geometry, and the concept of the zero. They had also introduced the numerical system still in use today. Throughout his travels, Ibn Battuta testified to the wonders of the Islamic Empire. Fez captured his heart, and he settled and made it his home. The mosque, worship and prayer are all elements of a past empire, which has been preserved. Fridays are known as Jummah, a day of communal prayer. For 1400 years, the Islamic community upheld the no-trade policy during this period. Upon completion of the communal prayers, or Salat, trade is enthusiastically recommended. Throughout the Islamic Empire, a harmonious relationship between commerce and religion has existed. It is this relationship that has kept commerce pure. The charging of interest, dishonesty, and greed are known elements associated with money. However, the great Islamic empires stand as alternatives to this norm. An empire built on the economic principles of a religion kept an entire nation both prosperous and godly for centuries.
Yeah.
the birthplace of the Renaissance, a whole new banking system was about to emerge. Banco is in effect an Italian word which means wooden table. And it was on these wooden tables that currency was exchanged for the illustrious golden florin, a golden coin of reputed quality. The florin merchants controlled the coin, and by the 13th century, the Islamic numerals had been adopted by Europe. Money changers became bankers, and merchants began experimenting in long-distance transactions and investments. The traveler's check first appeared in 14th century Florence. This valuable means of commerce provided a secure way of effecting international trade, as it allowed merchants to travel without carrying large quantities of gold, an obvious target for thieves and pirates.
Traveling across Western Europe at this time in the 13 and 1400s is dangerous. You have something which only you can cash. It's a piece of paper guaranteeing payment from one merchant or goldsmith to another. It's as good as gold, but nobody else can use it. It's very, very safe money.
The Medicis were a prominent and powerful banking family. Politics and money for the Medicis were inseparable. In 1433, control of the politicians fell into the hands of a rival family, which used the death of Giovanni Medici to seize political power. His eldest son, Cosmo Medici, was arrested and false accusations were made against him. His life was at risk. Through a series of bribes, he narrowly escaped death at the hands of his enemies. From this point on, he seized control of the Florentian political arena. It was said that he could rule the nation from his workshop. Though his fortune soared, Cosmo Medici always held a humble appearance, owning a mule instead of a horse. Because the Medicis were Catholic, the amassing of great wealth carried a stain in the Christian circles. Two roads to redemption lay at their feet: sponsoring great works of art and building magnificent churches. The financial favors that the Medici bestowed on presidents and popes had far-reaching consequences. Many great monuments still remain today, bearing testimony to the Medici name. For more than a century, the Italians were the power brokers in the West, whilst the Ottoman Turks guarded the trade routes to the East. However, the pursuit of gold for the Spanish would create empires almost overnight and take money to new frontiers. A merger of the old world with the new was about to take place in a marriage that would influence history forever.
IRFM, thought-provoking, always smoking, lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
When Christopher Columbus set sail in the name of Christ, Spain, honor, and greed, he stumbled on a magnificent and peaceful civilization of Amerindians, who had occupied this region for millions of years. His proud declaration of a new world came at a great price to the unfortunate Indians. To the people of this aptly named New World, gold had less of a financial value and more of a sacred religious one. Amerindian chiefs of the Andes in South America painted themselves with a sheen of gold as part of an elaborate religious ceremony. The chief would then dive into a lake to return the gold to the earth from which it had come. The Spanish, however, had a less symbolic depth to their gold cravens. In their campaign to conquer the region, the Spanish raped, pillaged, and plundered in an insatiable and unrelenting pursuit of gold. Death followed the gold in predaceous numbers. When a mountain was discovered in Potosí, South America spewed out masses of silver. The Spanish started to believe that they were chosen by God to inherit wealth and power. But with this wealth came a hidden curse. Back in Spain, prices increased by 400%, and numerous small wars broke out across Europe. With this new wealth in 1588, 150-ship armada was amassed and launched against England. The unfortunate fleet was torn in utter defeat and humiliation at the hands of a freak storm. Spanish royalty and nobility were oblivious to these events and continued to spend extravagant amounts of money on churches and art. Perhaps by investing money into churches was a way of justifying the horrific acts in which they had indulged in the pursuit of money. Within a century, the Kingdom of Spain was fading. The power was slipping into the hands of a few skillful and manipulative individuals. Individuals who would almost single-handedly control the outcome of wars and revolutions. London, England consists in reality of two cities, the financial district and the rest of the capital, including Crown Land. For nearly 1,000 years, the city and the crown have been as separate as church and country. The Queen must even request permission to enter the 1 square mile financial enclave that makes up the city. It even has its own unique police force. The roots of this arrangement are based upon money. In 1694, the Bank of England made an alteration that would change Britain and its money forever. The ensuing war against France was draining the crown of money, and a private fund was set up to assist the financially torn nation. The Bank of England was formed as a private venture funded by wealthy financiers such as international banker William Paterson, who was noted for boastfully saying that the bank half benefits off interest on all money it creates from nothing. The liberation of business activity of royal prerogative allowed the British economy to surpass that of Europe's. Money now marched side by side with England's might. In 1814, money was needed in the war against Napoleon. The Bank of England, however, could not meet this request. Money was needed for the waging war, but this time the money came from the Jewish banking families who served from the shadows the needs of kings and countries. In Europe, the role of the money changer became a shadowy one, being the domain of the exiled. Because of the networking nature of Jewish families, they took control of this profession. 7 generations of the Rothschilds have been involved in the banking business. The Rothschilds distinguished themselves as the most famous of all European banking dynasties. For some 200 years, they exerted great influence on the economic and indirectly the political history of Europe. Lionel de Rothschild.
Remember that all the little principalities there had different currencies and coinage, and so someone with a good memory and a quick wit could learn to do coin exchange and currency exchange.
250 years ago, Major Rothschild grew up in the Jew Street in Frankfurt, a place of cramped and subhuman conditions referred to as the ghetto, from where the modern word ghetto was derived. Major Rothschild became one of Frankfurt's richest Jews. Despite this, he was confined to the impoverished Yangasso every night. During the American Revolution, Prince Wilhelm made great profits by forcing the peasants into fighting the British wars against the American colonists. However, he was paid in English currency and had to turn to Major Rothschild to convert it to his local currency. When Napoleon had overrun Prussia, Prince Wilhelm fled, leaving his fortune to be hid among the Rothschild investments. The Rothschilds' enterprise now spread across the cities of Europe, run by Major Rothschild's sons. Nathan Rothschild, one of the 5 sons, had inherited his father's gift. He was sent to England to tap its industrial might and supply Europe with goods. Napoleon's tight blockade proved, however, to be a major obstacle to him. The Rothschilds hence devised an ingenious courier system, which hid delicate financial papers and gold away from Napoleon's blockades. The contributions of the Rothschilds' money to the economy of Britain was impossible to ignore. And so, at Waterloo, it was a Rothschild-financed army that crushed Napoleon. The Rothschilds made an enormous fortune from the war, and more importantly, amassed great influence and power in the whole of Europe.
Continent! Widmore Tabaruka! We are listening to our laments! You know here! Continent! The end! The end!
Over 400 billion US dollars are in circulation. It remains the most popular currency in the world. On every American dollar is the signature of Mary Eileen Withrow, the Treasurer of the United States.
Credit of the United States government. We want people to believe in it. We want them to feel they can trust it. People will use what they can trust.
Benjamin Franklin is one of the most significant faces on the American $1 bill. Born in 1706 into a poor family of 10, at the age of 12, he was apprenticed to a printer. Unknown to many, Benjamin Franklin was the most powerful hand in the introduction of paper money in the US. The problem with America's economy was due to the tax, which had to be paid to the British masters in silver. This depletion created a severe shortage and a deflation of the currency. Benjamin Franklin saw an opportunity to profit from the economic plague and made a proposition to the US government to introduce paper money on a full scale. The contract was issued, and Benjamin Franklin's power and influence grew. An influence with Masonic ends.
Major success in the printing business is to get the contract for printing money. You don't even have to charge. Just take care of the scrap.
By 1760, the printing of paper money was banned, and England demanded their taxes in coins. Benjamin Franklin was a clear loser where England was concerned, and he used his power and position with the government to create one of America's greatest conspiracies, the War of American Independence. A war that freed America of British dominance. A war that introduced a new market for its founders, namely Benjamin Franklin. In 1776, paper money was started up once again, and it is this money that was used to finance the war against Britain. Richard Doty of the Smithsonian.
As long as the revolution appeared to be going well, continental currency or the continental dollar held a value fairly well against real coins. But when the war went on indefinitely, the value of it began to drop.
With overprinting and the soaring of counterfeiting, inflation took its toll. In fact, inflation became so high that even counterfeiting stopped as the money lost all value. 80 years passed until paper currency was tried again in America. Benjamin Franklin, however, left more than his face on the U.S. currency. He left the symbol of masonry, the all-seeing eye. An adequate supply of money is indispensable to the so-called civilized world. Without money, industry would grind to a halt. The entire economic web would freeze. The only survivors would be self-dependent tribes and families. Money is truly the blood of society. It is the means of all trade. It is a measure and the instrument by which commodities are exchanged.
We want them to feel they can trust it. People will use what they can.
Money circulation in a country is regulated by specialist bodies, usually government-based. If too much money is made, then money loses its value, causing what we know as inflation. Prices soar to compensate, interest rates soar even higher, and the country is left in financial chaos. On the other hand, shortage of money has effects that are equally devastating. Testimony to this is the Great American Depression of the 1930s. In the 1930s, America did not lack industrial capacity, fertile land, skilled workers, or entrepreneurial businessmen. It had an extensive and highly efficient transportation system in the form of railways, network roads, and inland and outland waterways. Communication between regions and localities were the best in the world, utilizing telephones, teletype, radio, and a well-organized government operating mailing system. No war had ravaged the cities or the countryside. No pestilence weakened the population, nor had famine stalked the land. The United States of America lacked only one thing, an adequate supply of money to carry on trade and commerce. In the early 1930s, bankers, the only source of new money, had refused loans to new industries, stores, and farms. Payments on existing loans were required, and money rapidly declined from circulation. Goods lay in shop windows. Jobs were waiting to be done. The money drought brought an entire nation to a standstill. The greedy bankers had put America and Americans into depression. The bankers' plot had been successful. They were now the sole benefactors, accumulating thousands of homes, farms, and business properties. It was World War II that brought the depression to a sudden end. The uncooperative bankers of peaceful times had suddenly become cooperative with billions to spare to the military. A nation that only 2 years ago could not produce food for sale now suddenly bombarded German and Japanese soil with expensive complementary missiles. The bankers' artificial creation of a money shortage had left a nation devastated. For America, it became evident that he who controlled the money controlled the nation. Judgment at a global level. Politicians financed by criminal bodies are reluctant to pass legislations affecting the hand that feeds them. However, John Fitzgerald Kennedy did just that. It was alleged that the JFK presidential campaign success was due to considerable backing by the mob. The mob hoped that having a president in their pocket would secure their illegitimate enterprise. However, their plans backfired. And upon the mob hoped that having a president in their pocket would secure their illegitimate enterprise. However, their plans backfired, and upon being elected president of the United States, Kennedy waged an all-out war on organized crime. A few years later, he lay dead. The events surrounding the assassination are ultimately deeply rooted in the money game. Fidel Castro, in 1959, waged a bloody war against the Cuban dictator, General Batista. The mob saw the potential of an open market in Cuba, and with the help of the CIA, providing financial support via the mafia to ensure Fidel Castro's rise to power. In 1960, when Castro succeeded as dictator of Cuba, he ousted the mafia. U.S. businesses and agricultural estates were expropriated. Cuba then formed a trade alliance with the greatest enemy of the USA, Russia. And thus was sown the seed of a lifelong discord between Cuba and the US. Why does the US have an inherent hatred for Fidel Castro? Why does America fear this man's doctrines? Fidel Castro is one of the few men who has been wise to the propaganda and capitalist aims of the Western governments. He and his country endured in hostile climates, intact and unbroken, independent of capitalist control. When Fidel Castro turned to Russia, he became the first Western Atlantic country to become communist. This closed the door to the billions of enterprise that lay in Cuba for American investors. The mafia was looking for a country where they could operate above the law. Castro denied them this sordid privilege. The result for communist Cuba was years of sanctions and negative propaganda. Cuba was forced into a state of abject poverty. The silent war of attrition saw many presidents pass before Castro with the intention to break him and thus force open the doors to American enterprise and trade. A trade that, as in the case of Puerto Rico, sucks a country of its resources while filling the bellies of American capitalists on American soil. With war on the horizon, large contracts have to be issued. Someone needs to make the weapons of mass destruction, medicine, guns, and computers. In Britain and the US, gun companies and shipping yards have generated stores of wealth. In 1974, a Soviet diesel submarine with nuclear capability sunk to its death a few hundred miles off the coast of Hawaii. In one of the largest salvage covert operations of all time, the U.S. government security contracted multi-billionaire Howard Hughes for a two-year project worth millions. Howard Hughes was to use his industrial might and competence to design and build the mighty vessel to carry out the operation. One of the largest ships of the day was constructed to secretly hoist the wrecked submarine from its watery grave. The nature and details of this recon mission until this day are darkly kept secrets. But it is for sure that war and rumors of war have for a long time been a source of great financial gain.
Yo, the clash, I'm burning up the team under Ebola. Yo, suicide and murder, stone clash. Future soul, like Reggae King from St. Elizabeth. Poison down from Florida. And then a Ricky Trooper and a Sound Trooper family. November the 8th.
Always smoking. Lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Interest is a system designed where money loaned generates money as a principle of service. The money loaned is lost by way of spending while the debt endures. The debate concerning interest on the social economic platform is not a new thing. The philosopher Plato regarded interest as a means where the rich could exploit the poor. Aristotle, the Greek philosopher, believed that money was to serve as an exchange and not as a means to profit by use of interest. In the religious text of the Torah, Deuteronomy 23, interest is prohibited. You are not to exact interest on a fellow man, whether it be money or food or anything else. Interest cannot be charged. This was conveniently interpreted, however, by some Jews to mean Jew to Jew, hence making it legal to charge interest to non-Jews. At the Council of Nicaea in Christian era 325 AD, Emperor Constantine forged the Trinity, despite the strong opposition from the Christians of the time. However, on the subject of interest, the emperor failed to sway the uncompromising Christians. The church's decision was to cause friction for centuries in Europe. European merchants, in an attempt to circumvent the church, deployed many legal tricks, including one where three parties were involved, contractus trinus. Eventually, interest came to be charged in Europe in abundance, and eventually the church gave in neglecting the Bible in favor of democratic decree. In 1541, English law allowed the interest to be charged up to a fixed limit. Any excess of this was then considered unlawful. The church that had held out for centuries had finally given in completely. One Christian writer is noted as having stated that interest was necessary for salvation. Islam is the only religion on earth that incorporates in totality all aspects of a complete financial and government system. Islam thus combines the spiritual and the habitual. The issue of interest is made clear in the Holy Quran. O you who believe, fear God, and give up what remains of your claim of interest if you are truly believers. If you do not, then take notice of war from God and his apostles. In the history of Islam, there has never been any dispute by any person or persons, groups or individuals to this Quranic verse, and interest in Islam still remains forbidden. The interest-issuing groups, who make billions upon billions, have devised many ways to color and cloak many interest-generating systems. From bank accounts which accumulate interest, to credit card debts that are not settled before interest is applied, many people who are adverse to interest are caught up in its web in some way or another. Today, many bank accounts incur interest, and this is unfortunately seen as not a big issue. However, it is. Both the gaining and the issuing of interest is clearly prohibited by God's law. It is very easy for customers to write letters to their high street branches and request that no interest be added to accounts in credit. O you who believe, fear God, and give up what remains of your claim of interest if you are truly believers. If you do not, then take notice of war from God and his apostles. Control the credit of a nation, direct the policy of government, and hold in the palm of their hands the destiny of the people. After billions upon billions have been made, money as powerful and lust after as it is, wears thin. There is little lifestyle difference between someone with 20 million and 200 million. Money can only go so far. Power becomes the new sport, and world politics is the height of that game. It is fair to say a conscious or unconscious global banking conspiracy is in existence in our midst today. Names such as Barings of England, Rothschild, J.P. Morgan, Warburg. International bankers such as the Rothschilds are not the same type of bankers seen on the public high street. They deal with industrial giants of the world's institutions and local and foreign governments. The international banker creates the illusion that the money is being controlled by the government, when all the while it is being controlled by them. Rockefeller owned the Chase Bank, and the Warburgs own the Manhattan Bank. In a merger, the Chase Manhattan Bank was created. one of the most powerful conglomerates in existence, acting in consort with the Morgan banking dynasty. They spent millions of dollars to promote their campaign for legislation to gain a privatizing of U.S. money. They sold the idea to the public on the premise that current government legislation would work to propagate monopolies. Politicians all over the country cried for a new reform. To ensure a convincing case, the financial conglomerates publicly spoke out against these new policies, while secretly promoting it from the shadows. In December 1913, a short-staffed Congress voted in what was known as the Federal Reserve Act. The Federal Reserve is privately owned with stock held by 12 private banks, beyond and above the vote of the people. The president appoints 7 members to the Federal Reserve Board for a term of 14 years each. This serves to create the illusion that the government put into power by the voters ultimately control who governs this powerful body. However, no president in American history has appointed a member that is not congenial to the financial interest of the banking dynasties. The aim of the Federal Reserve Act, in essence, was propagated under the banner of removing money from politics. Many were and are still even today unaware that the Federal Reserve is a profit-making and private-owned corporation. Its aim, like most capitalist businesses, is first and foremost to profit. All other priorities are of a secondary nature. At the genesis of the Federal Reserve Act, the United States of America was divided into 12 federal districts, for which a board of directors was appointed. Trillions of dollars were made available to governments, businesses, and people, monies lent with the pending plague of interest attached. The U.S. government had spent more money than it had earned through taxation. The government then turned to the Federal Reserve to obtain money required to run the country. In this agreement, the government instructed the Treasury Department to print U.S. interest-bearing bonds. From the bonds obtained from the U.S. government, the Federal Reserve has created more and more credit, which it in turn loaned to businesses and individuals inclusive of pre-accumulated interest, establishing an ideal system whereby the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. The Federal Reserve in the U.S. serves as a line of credit when the government is in debt. The U.S. debt currently stands at $400 billion, which incurs $20 billion in interest per annum. Interest generated from nothing. Such power, reserved for those who control the money systems, is riddled with conspiracy and greed. Money manipulation by this one body shows how the influence and control of a few can affect the majority. Company plans, political prospects, rise and fall of certain industry, boom and depression, all controlled by the few. All controlled by money. The first Federal Reserve Board members were handpicked by Colonel Edward Mandell House, who represented British and American banking interest. Edward House, in 1912, wrote a supposed fiction novel entitled Philip Drew Administrator. The novel tells how a small group of insiders created a depression, then bring about the election of a handpicked leader who launches a program called New Era. The insiders weaken the country to the point of civil war, which provides the excuse for the implementation of dictatorship policies. People desperately looking for a way out accept with open arms their new oppressor. This story seems very likening to actual U.S. historical events. Edward House selected Woodrow Wilson as a presidential candidate, and when Woodrow Wilson became nominated, he later became his financial advisor. Woodrow depended on him exclusively. He even admitted that House was his alter ego. The link between money and politics, politics and ultimately the day-to-day lives of people, is inseparable. In this complex chain, the simple conclusion is clear. He who controls the money controls the people. The global system influences the people who rise to power. Only those that support the ultimate interest of the big money dynasties will be selected. They in turn select judges, administrators, ambassadors in a complex web that ultimately serves one master. The popular saying, two sides of the same coin, is just what summarizes this system. Political parties change, governments change, but this global system remains intact. And it begs the question, what group then sits at the head of this international table? In 1870, John Ruskin, an Oxford lecturer, taught to a group of his students that the state must take control of a country's production headed by one man, a man who was superior to all others. And amongst his students was none other than Cecil Rhodes, the ruthless racist dictator, who imposed his surname on what is now Zimbabwe. Cecil Rhodes, through his international banking contacts, amassed riches from creating a diamond and gold monopoly in Africa. In 1891, Cecil Rhodes established a secret society to promote the darker side of John Ruskin's dreams. Dr. Quidley explains.
In this secret society, Rhodes was to be leader. Stead, Brett, Lord Esher, and Milner were to form an executive committee. Arthur Lord Balfour, Sir Harry Johnston, Lord Rothschild, Albert Lord Grey, and others were listed as potential members of a circle of initiates. While there was to be an outer circle known as the Association of Helpers, later organized by Milner as the Round Table Organization.
After the death of Cecil Rhodes, the leadership of this inner circle fell into the hands of Lord Alfred Milner, High Commissioner of South Africa. As director of numerous public banks and corporate precursor of England's Midland Bank, he became one of the greatest financial and political powers in the world. He recruited many Oxford graduates into his inner circle. Dr. Quidley explains.
Through his influence, these men were able to win influential posts in government and international finance and became the dominant influence in British imperial and foreign affairs up to 1939. Under Milner in South Africa, they were known as Milner's Kindergarten until 1910. In 1909 to 1913, they organized semi-secret groups known as roundtable groups in the chief British dependencies and in the United States.
The Round Table preempted a secondary group in the United States called the CFR, the Council for Foreign Relations. It is through such organizations, universities, and tax-exempt groups that the global capitalist conspiracy has dominated and kept a grip on the world for over 50 years. The CFR was a front for financial giants such as J.P. Morgan, who ran it with the small but elusive American Round Table Group. The CFR has an elite membership of 1,400. They're sworn to secrecy, and the organization as a whole keeps a very low profile. One of the members, Joseph Kraff, in an article, Schools for Statesmen, published in Harper's Magazine 1958, stated one of the chief architects was Colonel Mandelhouse. He also stated that members of the CFR included the chairman of Atomic Industry, head of the CIA, members of the largest Wall Street giants, university lecturers, journalists from CBS, NBC, Newsweek, Times Magazine, Washington Post, directors from the Ford Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation, the Carnegie Endowment Fund, Presidents Hoover, Johnson, and Nixon. From media to presidents, the CFR has a very intimidating membership of some of the world's most powerful individuals for an organization the public knows next to nothing about. The question, so often asked, must once be asked again. What is the CFR? You can change the name, but the reality remains the same. Lodge, secret society, international bankers, Illuminati, it all equals one thing. Control of public opinion and the elimination of religion. As intelligent as a person is, everything that is known is from the world around. By controlling the source of knowledge, i.e. universities, magazines, television, radio, music, etc., it is possible to fashion an organic robot which bows to the commands of its master. Some people believe that conspiracy is non-existent, and others believe everything is a conspiracy. Sometimes, the conspirators strangely encourage conspiracy. Through propaganda wars, the media conglomerates create enemies. Once it was Russia and communism, which dominated the post-World War II era. But now with the fall of communism, the new enemy is the so-called Muslim fanatic. Propaganda paints a conspiracy against religious bodies, causing the masses to react adversely to religion at the mere whisper of the word. The aim is to distance creation from the Creator and adopt God's role. The target of the negative propaganda has changed throughout the years, but the method of injecting this poison into the masses has not changed one bit. The creation of an enemy, real or illusionary, has been supported by the people who seem to have the most to lose, as mentioned before. The British banker that financed Trotsky, the communist revolution in Russia, was Lord Alfred Milner. The CFR has funded many left-wing idealists. Why? Lord Howe's fictional work, depicting how by creating an illusionary enemy can bring about the control of a people by only offering solutions, which result in the desired outcome of the conspirators. The people see the proposed solution as a reasonable price to pay for the restoration of tranquility. Fear can create many things, and it is in this fear that some people make billions. It must be stated that a one-world government or a one-world economy is not flawed in its puritanical realm. It becomes tainted when the question of who runs it and why is asked. A world government based on the laws of God would be a perfect world to live in. What could be better? A system where morality and fairness remain unaltered by time. However, the pursuers of the global currency and global government are not the God-fearing kind. And it is this one factor that makes all the difference. They incited fear into the nations of the world. Fear created from an illusionary villain, intimidation. A common enemy needs a common reason for unification. They want no resistance to absolute control and economic growth and political steering of member states. Yes, America can give the world peace, but it is a piece of the expansion of the invisible American dictatorship. America has expanded its control beyond its borders. Anyone who opposes is propagated as an enemy of peace and equality. It has been a tool for the assimilation and manipulation of the resources of the world. America has no enemy. They have set up a climate favoring the World Bank and its policies and puppet governments. In 1944, at the International Conference held in Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, the IMF was born. Conceived from the ruins of a post-war Europe, the World Bank has created a vast web of exploitation and intrigue. Its victims, none other than potentially its greatest rivals, the so-called Third World countries. 800 delegates attended the Bretton Woods Conference at the invitation of the then President of the United States, F.D. Roosevelt. And it was at this conference, to a delegation still riddled by the ensuing wars, that America made its intentions clear. Free trade with no discrimination against U.S. goods. A favorable climate for American investment in foreign economies. And unimpeded access to raw materials. F.D. Roosevelt sold his policy on the back of the chimera that only free trade could guarantee post-war peace. Free trade equals equality. Equality equals peace. He argued that the 1930s Great Depression had allowed fascism to reign and that the currency disorders had destroyed the basis for international trade and investment. Bewilderment and bitterness had become the breeders of fascism, and fascism had led to a war. A war America had to end. In 1960, the International Development Association, the IDA, was established. Its aim was to provide interest-free loans to the world's poorest countries, unable to afford the IBRD's terms of agreement. These loans gave an impression of being lenient. They are not. It is these loans from the IDA which are responsible for the present debt burden of today's poorest countries. Mexico, India, Brazil, Indonesia, Turkey, China, Philippines, Argentina, Korea, Colombia, Morocco, and Nigeria all still struggle under their financial burden that repayment of the IDA loans have created on their economies. Their peoples live lives of misery and squalor, and yet no one stands accountable. Hiding behind the mask of national reconstruction, it is the World Bank's intention to force third world countries into submission.
Yes, may I tell you, the man I go right across the board when him talk about money. Serious thing. This is the Cutting Edge on IRFM. The time is 12 o'clock.
Brothers and sisters, this is Charlie. Join us with respect for our national anthem. Let us stand and defend this one. Peace and love. Thank you.
Eternal Father, bless our land.
Always smoking. Lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
And render them financially handicapped and politically weakened. And it is to Robert Strange McNamara, president of the World Bank, from April the 1st, 1968 to June the 30th, 1981, that credit is given. He masterminded the plot, which was to make the World Bank the most powerful establishment in the world. His previous role as United States Defense Secretary gave him first-hand knowledge of world systems and how they might be manipulated and controlled. It was he who introduced the concept of the World Bank's moral obligation to relieve world poverty. McNamara's motives were undoubtedly political. Behind the zealous crusading front, McNamara was calculating and scheming. He wore the hat of political activist as a means to an end. And it was in this crusading disguise that the World Bank began its strategic domination of the poorer nations of the world. Third world countries were recklessly bombarded with IDA loans. The borrowing governments rarely refused a loan or worried about their position to repay it. To the investors, World Bank involvement signaled to the rest of the world that they had nothing to fear. It had become a necessary seal of approval. McNamara's final legacy had far more sinister consequences. His parting gift was the era of structural adjustment, known as policy-based lending. These loans came with inescapable conditions, insensitive to the individual and cultural needs of the countries involved. Conditions which possessed the ambition of transforming entire societies, setting a new set of westernized social goals. Programs that have since devastated the lives of millions of people, whilst making the World Bank very rich indeed. McNamara's prime concern was in fact to obtain a state of general stability for himself and his country. His solution to the dreaded communist threat was not to eradicate poverty, as he pretended, but to bring poorer nations under his control. It was not his intention to create conditions for economic and social progress in the lesser developed areas of the world, but in fact to create a system so entangled and indebted to America as to remove any threat of political rebellion. By fueling the irrationally and self-destructiveness of unbridled emotion, greed, aggressiveness, hatred, ignorance, and inertia The World Bank has brought many, if not all, third world countries to submission. Order, stability, and security for the North has been obtained through elimination of any political, financial, or social opposition. Although McNamara left the bank more than a decade ago, his policies hauntingly remain. In 1979, the World Bank launched its careful devised lending systems in the form of structural adjustment loans and pectoral adjustment loans. These loans tap into the very core of a country's political and financial infrastructure and spread like a disease to its peoples. The main incentive of the bank's loans is to liberalize the rules and regulations of a country in a direction favorable to America and Americans. With four types of loans and the capacity to coordinate them strategically, the World Bank controls many aspects of investments, institutional development, and public policy in nearly 150 nations. High African officials say TINA, short for There Is No Other Alternative, a vicious web of catch-22s from which there is no return. The World Bank has to be held accountable. And yet the bank continues unopposed, preaching market theology and avoiding the consequences of those misreadings. The bank wins, whatever the final outcome. The quest for money has led to an insatiable greed on the part of many large industries and businesses. Millions are spent on learning behavioral patterns of people to predict spending patterns and trends. Psychologists, economists, and marketing specialists are constantly employed by major corporations to typecast and analyze to the point where people are just numbers and points on a graph in obscure computer programs. The data is crunched in complex algorithms and program queries with one intention: predicting and controlling others. This information allows analysts to market products with such precision as to be able to predict consumers' response with almost assured success. This technique has been so refined that sales predictions are almost 100% accurate. Loyalty cards are an effective tool used to monitor general consumer habits. Do you have a loyalty card? Is often the first utterance to greet customers at checkout points. Loyalty cards often bear the name of the store. Sainsbury's card and Shell card are but two of thousands in the UK alone. They all work on a similar basis. The more money you spend, the more points you accumulate. At specific point levels, you are entitled to gifts or cash back. On the surface, the name loyalty card guarantees just that: customer loyalty. It is in the consumer's interest to stay with one store or chain and accumulate points, as cards are not transferable. There is nothing wrong with that, except the agenda goes deeper. When you are given a loyalty card, you fill in all your details and the card is processed and activated in a computer database. Every purchase you make from this point on can now be monitored. How much money was spent? On what was it spent? When was it spent? How frequent? A marketing manager's dream. In addition, your every movement is monitored by security cameras within the store. This highlights which aisles attract the most people. Do you buy bread first, followed by butter? Which products are not of interest to you? How did you respond to new marketing gimmicks in the store? Your general buying decisions. All of this information is at their disposal to be analyzed and deciphered until you become as predictable as a mathematical equation. Information can then be banded together into groups of single men, women, couples, families, etc. This information can then be sold to third parties for exorbitant amounts. McDonald's, one of the world's largest fast food giants, takes marketing research to another level. It hires low Earth orbit satellite time to conduct population development surveys. This information is used in the geo-positioning of future stores. From the Islamic Holy Land to the poorest country in Africa, McDonald's has found itself a home within almost every potential money market. tapping into the resources of young and fragile economies, piping illusionary concepts of an American dream full of excess, waste, and greed. Concepts and ideas, the very nature of which ultimately destroy any country not operating at the Western economic level. To these major chains, money is their prime concern. All other issues, including the welfare of a people, are superseded. What can and what cannot make money is a very interesting subject. These days, it seems that there are very little niche ventures that are not profit-making. Even selling obscure plots of land on Mars has been done. In light of the new Martian mission, Search for Life, some real estate agents have been selling plots of Martian land. Strangely, in the US, this practice is finding clientele, and it is not even illegal. Fear and all its components is another good sales tactic. Either create a fear of someone losing something, or create a fear of an event coming. The best example of this is the mysterious Millennium Bug, which failed to show up for the Millennium celebrations. Nonetheless, books were written about it, computer programmers were in demand, software came with the Y2K seal of approval. Computer consultants were running amok, and for what? For money. It is hard to estimate how much money was earned by the service cure end of the industry. Possibly billions. All on one word. Fear.
You know, say before we go on to the other part, there's two things you mentioned a while ago, McDonald's and Mars. Well, I want to tell you, say, at least 70,000 people book them flight for go Mars already. And we must know that the man who hold Virgin, Branson, him, as a matter of fact, he did a test flight something the other day and it never worked out, but him have a plan for send families to the moon. I think a $250,000 for a flight to the moon. And we hear that Lady Gaga is supposed to perform in space next year. I would love to go to that performance. Believe you me, but as the man talk about how they must sell everything. Imagine Monday or some Mars over there, some man actually a buy out Mars already. And him don't know who they pan it. It's so same way them come and buy out certain place, not even buy it out. Capture it and kill all the people them. Before you say buy, you know, it means say there's somebody on earth who do have nothing to do with Mars, who decides say he must sell some part of Mars. And the next thing is about McDonald's. Did you know that McDonald's main interest is not burgers, it's real estate? Yes, it's real estate them into, not burgers. Them use the burger thing, but check it. Them all over the world, real estate them into. This money thing, is a serious, serious thing. This is the cutting edge on RFM.
If ever man created anything from nothing, it is money. Economists use the term created because the modern concept of money is a non-existent artificial term. A woodsman makes a house, but the wood is from the trees. Automobiles are made by man, but all the materials involved are created by God. Man has merely reinterpreted the raw materials to suit a specific purpose. Money wants a bit of paper, is today a mere electronic cyber pulse. The value of this paper or electronic pulse is negligible. Yet it can be used to build a house, buy a car, a boat, or even a cup of coffee. All acquirable through the same note or electronic pulse. And so it is to nothing a value is assigned. A value whose worth we must all collectively believe in. Without this belief, money would have no value. America has grown into the wealthiest nation on Earth. a society built on capitalist principles and consumerism. The whole first world bows to the calling of money. Donald Trump.
Money for me is that it really is just a scorecard. It tells you if you've done well or if you've done badly. It really is just a scorecard.
Those who own it are revered, and those that don't are scoffed. Money seems to buy respect in the capitalist jungles of the world today. Extravagant Hollywood stars display this excess beyond practical purposes to a dazzled public, while the majority of the human race suffers a sub-animal existence.
I think the show of wealth in my case really is the great buildings that I built. Trump International Hotel and Tower, Trump Tower. I own the Empire State Building. I own 40 Wall Street, which is one of the great buildings in the world. I love great buildings. And in a way, that's a show of wealth. But at the same time, it's something that just has made me a lot of money.
Money is worshipped as a religion in the West. The pursuit of it is an addictive one. Supply never satisfies demand. Husbands are constantly working overtime to get that extra dollar. Wives work long hours to supplement their husband's income. Children seek jobs to supplement their spending money, as they too, at a very early age, join the consumer assemblage. Money is that fleeting illusion, that carrot on the stick, forever pursued, yet never attained. The word money dominates Western conversation and is the silent underlying evil that gnaws away at its foundation. The world has been intentionally kept in ignorance. Ignorant people are easily controlled, easily convinced, and easily predicted. Education and knowledge make people interact with wise eyes, aware of the reality of a system intent on governing their destinies. A system that favors the robot to the enlightened. A system that detracts from the pursuit of knowledge of self, the world, and God. Money, though essential for survival, needs, like every other aspect of our lives, to be balanced. If its pursuit deadens the soul, then what we are as a people dies. Money, they say, cannot buy the things that really matter. Love, happiness, friendship, a beautiful place in the hereafter. Money is of this world, and like everything of this world, it will perish.
Open your mind. Halakha Media, the signature of quality and expression.
Thought-provoking, always smoking, lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Corporate cannibals. Criminals. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM. Cutting Edge, you know what I'm saying? The Virgin there a while ago was very thorough in his money reasoning from the historical perspective up to the point of the International Monetary Fund. But you know something? I love y'all Peter Phillips this to listen to, you know. Because Peter Phillips, the same exact word where the brother say, them put me in a bind till we say there was no other alternative. Peter Phillips echoed that same thing there. You know, there's no other alternative to the IMF, but the IMF, but to go to the IMF. And that is exactly the bind them put me in. I don't think him feel same get caught, but really and truly him get caught. Yes, because the same word, there's no other way, there's no other alternative. And I remember a sister tell me, a filmmaker tell me, say, she asked him about it in terms of him radicalism and him in liberal reasoning from them time there. And him tell her, he could see him word, there was no other way. There was no other way. That is really where them put me in continuously. So, Aboriginal talk to me and I said, Buta, remember long, long time ago you play one thing about paycheck. You bring more than just a paycheck. And I said to myself, say, if I forget everything else, I'm not going to forget this because sometimes you play some music and you say some things and through your insider so by yourself and just talk to the mic, if you say, I wonder if anybody hear what you say, really. But when I hear the brethren come to me with the, I don't know, it look like it affect him profoundly to the point where he could have really remember. Because sometimes a man has remember certain things, but he not remember it specific. But this brethren was so specific that I say, if I don't remember anything else, I'm going to have to remember to play this thing after the brethren. So for the brethren who tell me, ask me, if you play this thing, I'm going to play it. More than a paycheck.
We bring more than a paycheck.
More than a paycheck we had. Carry one more leap of disease.
More than a paycheck.
Stress. Pain, injury. Can you believe that?
More than a paycheck.
More. Yes, this is the culture. Yes, El.
Democratic greetings, I Congo.
Blessed man.
You know, we are listening, we are here, people talk to the dollar die. Money is chief god in Babylon, you know. Chief god. Of all the gods in Babylon, money is chief god.
Yeah, man. A Jesus, that man.
Yes, serious thing. Good over evil, you know. Give thanks to them continental youngs. they are start out the program with, you know?
Yeah, it's South African vibes, yeah, man.
Yeah, we love. You know, at one time, we almost asked why, because once ago, I used to play them I more, you know, and one time, we almost asked why. What happened to the continental
youngs? No, we don't forget them, man. We don't forget them at all. We can't forget that, man. African music straight up.
Yes, right. Yeah, man. Talking about continental young, it was good to be amid emperors and emperors, you know, gathering, chanting Ayabingi for the 84th anniversary of his and her.
Yes, majesty.
You know, yes, coronation.
It was wonderful.
Yes, very good to be there.
Yeah, man, give thanks, man.
Give thanks for everything, you know, and you know, his majesty is pleased, you know.
Yes.
And I just say it up a girl, you know, because I know, say, it's just about Black liberty. As I always say, you know, the highest form of black consciousness is Rastafari.
Yes.
You know, without any apology, without, you know, it cannot be disputed, you know.
Yeah.
And I live black, you know.
Yeah.
And now you bring you out to the house where, you know, purchase that, you know, highest form nation, and we give thanks to be part of that house. You know?
Yeah, man, give thanks, Bridget.
Yes, I Congo, Rastafari.
Isis. Yeah, man, and as the Bridget talk about it, we deliver it. Serious thing, yes. Cutting edge. Yeah.
Yes, Mota.
Yeah, bless
you. Yeah, Mota.
Yeah, man.
Hey. About your one, as me say, I want to play back some of the tape them where they play already.
Yeah, which are one of them that you just play.
Yeah, about 96. One of me that play a tape. But some, I think, got tape concern about Mary.
Mary?
You see that night there? I mean, exactly, because you would have gone now. Coming like them, you tamper with the frequency. You couldn't hear it come across clearly at all. I mean, saying, coming like them, you don't want the people to hear that tape there.
Why they don't want? Some of them play over and over. I don't know which one you play, but most of them tape are not only one time you play them, you know.
I never hear you play one day again.
But Mary.
I never really miss, yeah, man, something. But as me say.
Only that you remember, Mary.
Something to watch she did in there, because when I hear the tape come on, it's like I couldn't hear nothing. It's like something that you know,
yeah, not properly. Yeah.
It's like how I could have said, well, then you play the rival of Jesus.
You're the rival. Yeah. You know, some plan to play about that's why we are keep, hey, watch out, you can't play too much time, you know, cab.
No,
people who didn't hear it one time, never hear it, and people who are
you
didn't
know
hear it.
Say,
yeah.
You know, say, since just started coming with the stepping razor, more younger people tune in
to this program, you know.
Yeah,
of course, we know that.
So,
man.
You see, now when you play them tape, you know, man, say, but anyway, because me follow you from them time, 96.
Well, if you talk about 96 to right, it's a long time, you did the planet, man.
Yeah, man, every country, me all remember you play one interview one pastor man from South Africa.
Yeah,
and you said to him, say, you play all them this, you tell the church people all them things, ne?
Yeah, but maybe, you know, one thing could I remember what sound like what you talk about is the Sister Charlotte tape, but I know that you talk
about. It wasn't Sister Charlotte tape, because
you don't remember that. What time, yeah. But I'm you talk about.
It's a way back tape.
Yeah, but you have to give me more information, man. You have to give me more information.
But anyway, pertaining to, I don't say too long, pertaining to the money thing now.
Yes.
When you listen to that, you know, me always tell certain people, say, look here, it's not about, say, well, then, socialism and capitalism. When you come to capitalism, if you're sensible, you can manipulate it still, you know, but here you do it now. You say, Marcus Garvey was the only economic philosopher we did ever have still, you know, since him we don't have no more.
Mm.
And the people, them not really listen to what him say and follow what him teaching.
Yeah.
But if, come here and say, look here, if people that form organization, you know, and organize themselves around the system, you know, you wouldn't have so much poverty still, you know, because we'd have take back some of their money where they must store up. Mm. Because look here now, when you buy your shoes, your only benefit you get out of the shoes is when you wear it, you know, and then the money gone. But suppose you have an organization where provide these commodities. And when you buy it, it could have gone and set up all credit union and you get the money if you borrow it out, your interest are low interest rate like how the Jew them do. Or you hear them say, boy.
No, the Muslim them not interest rate, yeah.
The Jew them not do it too.
Okay,
them not do it
okay,
too.
Yeah.
And even, I mean, here, this man already won the same basketball team that them take away from a dear. John Sterling. Him say, them help them one another, and he lift them, lend them one another money, them not collect it back till you. Till you really stand up on your foot firm enough when you know, you achieve certain things. So them help them one another. But we don't have nothing set up, we help one another. Right now, yes, you know, and you talk about oppressor, but nobody right now oppress them one another like poor people.
Yeah.
They oppress them one another.
The oppressed so, become the oppressor.
Yeah, they oppress them because you are trying to do a little thing at the same poor man want here.
Right, and as a matter of fact, him not support you neither.
Right, you know that?
MC Euro shop, you saw the Chinaman shop, this time, you got the Chinaman shop, because the Chinaman can buy in a bulk and sell cheap and you can't.
And sometimes the Chinese them network too, because they will come together and buy a material and you can't even load it.
The only set of people means to do that to the people them in the arcade, you know. Them black women, they know about business, you know.
Yeah, them do it.
Them put together and go foreign, go, one of them go buy things and come back.
Yeah, but them carry down them one another to me, I tell you.
No, wait. The Chinese no carry down one another to one?
Yeah, it happened to you, know.
Yeah, so nobody carry down one another, but we just say the concept of bulk. The concept of bulk is also practiced by a whole lot of people in the arcade.
Yeah, them do it, but one of the things I like what them do, you see if the one I got new in the business and say, all right, buy something for me at China. Him say, XYZ feet, give me $2,000. And when him come down, him say, but I don't say, this me could I get feet, guy, I'm a bit
crazy of a himself,
yeah. So, you know,
him don't charge you, but him charge you.
Him charge you more than if him did charge you. So that I think like kind of really something me hear about, you know, something me know, cause me are really living it, you know.
No, when me know about the going to all of them bulk up and send one go buy things.
Yeah, but them care down them one another, I tell you. But it doesn't mean, let me tell you something. Most of the things that happen with we as black people with one another, you know, me say not me not a race, you know.
Yeah.
Because me that say,
well, that's why I mentioned it too. That's why I mentioned it is the Chinese people care down Chinese people said we.
Right, because I wanna say every race of people equal. Once every man don't may not have the same level of intelligence. But that's what mean to say every race of people not equal. You know, every race you can find whether a great baller or a great singer or a great engineer or a great lawyer, it just come down in all the races. So it don't really mean to say that race is better than that race. And just because of white people, you know, you don't frame history, because sometimes you say, you don't need to study the history and hear what happened in Europe. So when you realize that them people don't really have a better time than we. I just threw them the far ahead of we.
Yeah, but them people that come in slave are the people still. And the other people right. Never enslaved.
After them go through for them great struggle.
No, it no matter where them go through. Me, I said them, a whole heap of you, after the plague, when them never rise up on certain level and them start to put themselves together, at that time them start to invade other country and take out people as and turn the
plates. Yeah, because the plague has happened in the 30s.
Yeah, so...
But looking at that time, they know, it's better to call them really loose and never put them, because they do them. You have one era in Germany where Jew live,
yeah,
and them use the law and keep for them era clean. And them I say, boy, them send the plague upon them.
Yeah, them kill out the Jew them, them go kill the Jew them.
Just yeah, because of the way of them system work and work out, yeah, them. By law.
That will happen in Jamaica too, you know. If a bowl of Richard, that same thing will happen.
Yeah, because you see, so you see, Allah is supposed to run a country still, you know.
Yeah.
And you can apply certain discipline to your life. Because even when you see them that talk about them, you look for him and say, what we talk about now? That's the last thing I talk about. When you talk about the people who surround Jesus and anything about the Gnostic gospel, them not give you the gospel. And they say Thomas are the doubtful one.
And
you, say, you know, so when them say when they read Thomas book, you know, I think that you read night to apply it to your life to make your life better.
So you never read Thomas, you never read the Saint Thomas book yet?
No,
get it
no,
and read it, man. Trust me, get it and read it, man. A total different thing. The same Thomas to them say doubt.
Mm-hmm.
I mean that, man. I mean that.
I never read it, but I'll try and get it.
Yeah, man. Give thanks, brethren.
Anyway, yeah, man.
Yeah, the brethren has doing thing and same peace. This is a next. Well, the first one, the day the dollar die was Peter Tosh himself, but this is the Wheelers. This is a big, big tune from them time there, you know. Listen, big, big tune. I only pound don't know nothing about pound and shilling and pence. Well, pound and shilling and pence were using at the colonial times. Brian, you know about pound, shilling and pence?
What do you mean?
You know about pound, shilling and pence, all right? How much shilling make a pound? A wise answer that, believe you me, is a wise answer. Wally. Anyway, this is the pound get a blow. Beeping and wheeling. May I tell you? Yes, blessed.
King Mota.
How is this?
Mota.
Yeah, man, me I hear you, man.
Yeah, my want to play the tribute there where you make the Lucky Dube.
Oh, and you mean my poem?
Yeah. Okay. And we're not where we can get the album.
The album, oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I don't know if I tell you about the album then. South Africa, it released, you know.
Me, yes,
you can go up online and get it, you know, iTunes.
Oh, online.
Yeah. You know, so I have some of them myself, but me not the near them now.
Alright, I'll go for online.
Yeah, yeah. Alright, if you see me one of them cultural activities, maybe I may have some for myself too. Can we just get some?
Oh. All right. And tomorrow I want to play one song where you play long time.
Which one?
About one man I talk about the pastor him. Some pastor him say, I have a dream.
Oh, that's a Maccabee.
Maccabee.
Maccabee sing it, yes. Me can't, you know, I'm play it now. Me can't play it now, you know.
Alright, man.
But me play the lucky one first, though. Me play the lucky one. Alright. Alright, right, blessed.
Yeah, Mota, real thing, them attack. Not you, that start listening to the program.
Yeah, alright, sir. He say, we're all slaves until Africans are free. Yes, tribute to Lucky Dube. Yes, Brett said. Give thanks. Yel.
Greetings again, I come.
Ah, blessed man.
Fitting tribute.
Yeah, man.
You know, within the scheme of this money system, you know, the most wickedest thing they set up on, you know, especially we as continental people out here, so, in these Western places, it's class system, you know.
Yeah.
I'm going to dictate the class system there, you know.
Of course. It divides
the system, man. I got comment on it one time, but I say, how can they divide the people? But it's a terrible system.
Well, you know, say, in a place where pure black people there, them use the money class system to divide up the same black people there.
The same people come in the same shape.
Yeah.
That's how dangerous the system is, you know.
Yeah, man. Money, man. Seriously. Money them use and divide it up, man.
Yes, I.
And now, even now, where you hear the Peter Phillips that said there was no other way but the IMF, that is how them set it, that you don't see no other way out.
You see those people who enter into the Westminster style politics that is of our way?
Yes. enemy to the people, them. Enemy. Yes.
You can count on your finger.
Yes.
If you can count at all, who enter into that wobbling politics and do not be a politician.
You know, your man mentioned Castro, you know the thing.
Of course.
All right. When me I grew up, you know, me hear say Castro definitely, you know, are evil.
Yes.
And now we see this country, who they near to America, so near to America.
Yes.
The minister of health have to go to Cuba to get some assistance and some reasoning towards how they would really deal with the Ebola. Because a little country like Cuba send a portion of doctor Ghana, Liberia, go deal with Ebola.
Yeah, man. They remain untainted, you know.
Really, if this country is so terrible, how is it that there's no illiteracy in Cuba? Them have a better health service than America. America sanction and embargo them for almost 50 years now. And in that 50 years, them could have developed a health system, a literacy program. Them could have an army. Could have sent Guala, Angola and all them places to go fight.
Yeah, man.
How is it that this country is so evil?
The white supremacy system.
Yeah, all them so evil and them now. Yeah. It's, imagine, you know, the big bad that's America, you know. Big bad America have an embargo upon them for nearly 50 years. And yes, them man. Could have helped them citizens by making no illiteracy there. No illiteracy that everybody can read. You see how terrible that is?
Yeah, man, that is the transformation
Yes. That
is needed.
So and when the man so tell about cute. capitalism, you know, gone mad. I should have played that one little.
Me I tell you?
Mm. All right, Bridging, give thanks.
Terrible. Yes. I have been guy.
Yes. Yes, so the Bridging, the you.
I had a dream.
Me I tell you, man. It just mind boggling to me. Me I watch them foreign evangelists, them call them prosperity evangelists. We are telling us just send $1,000 and you'll get it back abundantly and all them things. And people actually send them money. Them man there, all of them have a private jet, big house, that's a big house, that's a nice cut suit. The people them really believe say, it's God them people they pray to. And God bless them so much that them get all of them things that them can't say at them same one I give the preacher the private jet and the big house and woolly nice suit and them thing there. It's a terrible thing. It's capitalism gone mad. Yes. Cutting edge, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man. Mota.
Yes, sir. Yeah, man, listening up, Regine.
Yeah, man. Let me not have much time, but the thing is, the most interesting thing I'm going right now, I don't know, I have some people around me, I don't know, so well, we as a people are privileged to own land. It kind of strange, if you really say it, I can't believe I live around people who really have them a mindset, yeah.
Of which mindset, them ma'am?
Say, we're not privileged as a people to own land.
Why them say? Why them say
it,
that?
It now not feasible for we to own land. Mm. And Jamaicans, you know, feasible for we to own land. Like, can me look against the word squatters, because being Jamaican, we can't see where we are squatters.
Yeah, we're not squatters, but why, what them feel say we should oppose to own?
Obviously,
we're not in a position for him to go on. Him credit done. Man, credit done. All right, him credit done, and that's how it go. Can't fight that. But the same old way, we not supposed to own. As a matter of fact, we're not supposed to own nothing really. Did you know that it was in the Constitution? It was on the books that black people, the only business venture we should be able to pursue was to sell fish and ground provisions. Yes? Yes. It's not me, that's why, you know. It was there. I don't know if it's still there. But ground provisions and fish was what we were regulated to in terms of commerce. Wow. Jamaica land we love. Maccabee, a teacher with the music, man. Jamaican language. Okay, a serious thing. Yes, cutting edge.
Yes.
Bless him.
Give thanks, Muta.
Yeah, man, bless him, man.
Yeah, well, but as a teacher, one of the things I'm going to find out, you see, the youth, them don't know any words. So all the beautiful tapes where you play and thing, after the importance is lost because they don't understand words. And so,
like one for instance, give me like an example.
For example, just basic local words where you know, you don't expect students, people to know. I mean, you know, you explain certain things and you talk and one and two local words. The youth, them just don't have no form of word where them know the meanings of. They can read, but they don't know the meaning of basic words. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
And so as a result, they will be doing certain, you'll be trying to teach them certain things, and after the meaning is lost on them because them not understand basic words. So,
no, but when I say as a teacher, give me an example of what you talk about.
Why, Mr. Pent up and nervous to talk to you about the world thing?
That no, but why you nervous? I'm over phone you there, man.
The correct example.
No, man, they know you are saying, man, give me an example. Like, for instance, in your class, simple words that make it difficult for your teacher, the thing where you teach. Or you have to think too long. You are dead here, the thing.
All right. Because of that, we did basically call for talk about still.
Okay, all right.
Alright, the main thing I have to talk about is that today, may I listen to a tape where you play from long time.
Today, you mean?
Yeah, man.
In the day?
Yeah?
In the day, you listen to it?
Yeah, man.
Okay.
Me record it from in the 90s.
Okay, so me dey on the right track, come here, tell me I go play some tape from them time. They know me, yeah, man, I call about tape.
Yeah, man, so the tape that you played was a tape on the effects of sugar.
Okay, yes, part of the body, yes.
Yeah, man, with hypoglycemia.
Yes.
Where the man has said, boy, it mimic all the psychotic behaviors. The effects of sugar can mimic the most violent psychotic behavior.
Yes.
You can find.
That's why they use them so hype.
That's why they're not. Not only that's why they're so hype. That's why they are behaving like how they behave in. Because in the schools, too. The youth, them eat pure bug juice,
yes,
and sugar bun,
yes,
and it's just a barrage of sugar.
Yes.
And the cheese tricks with the MSG, and so all of them things there, just come together for give with the same.
Create another monster. But you know, sir, it has been scientifically proven,
right,
that a lot of the way you just talk about a while ago, them kind of behavior there in the children them.
Right.
It's caused by the excess of sugar.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The tape was saying that too.
Yeah, and to the point where now in Dubai, them have a law now, you know, we say you can't give your children junk food to carry go to school, and you can be charged if when them check the lunchbox.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if them go wrong or police will go wrong or check the lunchbox.
They will, man, in Dubai, they do that.
If the amount of sugar exceed the amount where you're supposed to have there, them can't charge parents.
But based on the effects on it, should be criminal.
Yes, it's a drug, man.
It's a terrible thing, and the youth, them act it out every day. You see,
yeah, man. Definitely.
One of the things them say, youth will just be once them sugar level drop, then we just become violent and attack you, and say like several people can't hold them down.
Yes,
and we see that play out in a school daily.
Of course, it's a drug, man. Definitely a drug. But we have to keep hammering this until somebody up there now decides, right, you know, say, We're supposed to take a stock of this thing and more than what we really are doing. But we don't have to tell them from so long.
But what me see, them not really have no interest in doing that, you know.
Yeah.
I think we as a people.
Well, we have to hammer it, and not feed you people too much sugar. And yeah, no sugar at all, yes.
And we have to start our own means of propaganda to educate our children.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, we have to do that, and we have to stop look at propaganda as being a bad thing. Because
no, propaganda is something where you can use for good at the interest of the people, them.
Exactly.
You use propaganda at the interest of the people. Marcus Gay have a whole topic about propaganda in them.
Yes,
we need
to do that, because even the other day with the Farrakhan thing, we not hear, no, apart from IRFM, nobody else has nothing about it. That's because we don't control our own propaganda.
Yes. All right, brethren, give thanks. Yes, sir?
Give thanks.
Yes. Yeah, man, a serious thing. And listen to this. Cutting edge, yes.
Yes, Uncle Mota, DJ Kev, Alabama.
How you doing, man?
Good day, man. How you doing, sir? No of them documentary, I mean, love, you know. No of them all documentary.
All right, sir.
Lucky. Yeah, man. That's the worst thing, man. I like how this money theater, it touch everything from Constantine to communism and even World Bank right now. When name it? When name that one? You remember?
Shadows, man. Shadows 2.
My name?
Shadows 2. Shadows. Money. Yeah, S-H-A-D-O-W. Shadows 2. Money.
Okay. Earlier, I'm here to big up the youth. Then we record the cutting edge. And I really, two of them still record it. I have a brother named Duke Bassey out of England. Where I the big artist more time of some hit song in South Africa, but he used to conduct on a bus in East London.
Who name?
And him cut
Who name?
Duke Bassey. And him used, Duke Bassey,
yeah.
And him cut a version of the tune about sugar, do you love me? Remember that tune there? Yeah, then you have Romeo Green out of Oklahoma now.
Okay.
I'm just 25. You want to say, if on your talk, cause to them, I'm a reason is if I say, boy, I want to make a difference in Jamaica. More black man, they own more business, and I mean, I tell them, say, everything starts in people, their mind, you know? And me, I'm a reason, they tell me, say, you see, channel what him have now, your thing, them have million views, him have funny, you know?
Him have a million views.
Yes, on the channel where you put the corner now.
I listen to the Stepping Razor and the Cutting Edge.
Yes, I just to last week in Mr. Miller. I said, if you make you want to heal you up and give thanks for energy over years.
Stick up in. The youth have a, what you call it, internet channel.
Yeah.
And him play the Stepping Razor and the Cutting Edge.
Mm-hmm.
And him have a million views.
A million. Him just started must be last year.
Wow. Yeah,
and you see better than him Duke Bassey in North England, a 4 million views him have.
4 million views.
Yeah, almost 4 million, but
they're original England at all.
Yeah, him that did for a long time though, from 10 years ago.
Okay.
Almost 4 million. So Yeah, man, it's important. Even me record them too. I mean, believe my children, and my children should have listened to them.
That's why when I go out in some place in Africa, the man tell me to hear the coaching head, but me not see them and spend no money. I'm realize, a YouTube.
And but you see, no, say, I heard something down here now and a big problem.
No, we get the information, say it's on demand. You get the program, them on demand.
People are searching them as it done, because they miss it, if they go to work, or them drop asleep. You know, people drop asleep like Brian, or Brian had drop asleep right now. You know, see it.
Where that? YouTube that. Oh, gosh, man. Muta big by YouTube.
Yeah, I swear, man.
You see, if you don't look for them, everyone's hard look for YouTube, you know, that time. Brian just log in by YouTube a while ago, and...
Oh, he's not asleep.
No, your wife not asleep, you know. We get a new co-producer. Right? Assistant named Manig. So, him can't sleep in Manig in the studio.
Yeah.
I have to go make you go and run. I have to tell Kabu, say, must make you stay in here with me till 2 o'clock.
Yeah.
That him not sleep. Yeah, man.
Enough thing they find enough from here talk about Sister Charlotte to Devil. Long time, man. A long time the brother England Duke BSC upload thing. Long time.
I have to go meet him, man. Because I go at some place and I wonder how the people them know about the you know, some things to them I talk to me about. I sit down in a camp the other day and I sit down in the hotel lobby and some youth come to me and them I talk some things where I hung upon cutting edge at stepping ways and I say them things that them say, yeah man, we are this street man, we get it off of YouTube. I say, what? Serious thing. Now this man has shown me some things I know. Them have put a picture with me between the, beside the program them.
Yeah,
we have so naive to them things that we do we are going out there.
What's the picture? Yeah, we with man.
Yes, I'm blessed, man.
Yes, Mota. Kush Hunter, you know?
Kush Hunter.
Yeah, Kush Hunter. I'm there in Queens, yeah,
all right.
In Alabama, I have a link, DJ, Kev, you
know? I want to link you up in the phone.
You see, I'm there, I listen to the whole program from night, you see me? From the documentary, I come straight up to the callers, then, you see it?
Give thanks, man, give thanks.
And you don't know, he's a man ever give me the strength from Rasta and a few pound greens alone, them time, you see it? So,
yeah, everyone I told them, man.
So they have a new thing, I never knew a thing, and now I'm here, Ellie Skelly, I'm here, I'm here, alright, yeah, I go get it tomorrow, cause the producer, I go get up on the radio live with Mama Ellie.
Oh, tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow.
Today.
We just give her a copy.
Yeah, alright, Bridget.
Because Vaseline February now.
Yeah, okay. Give thanks, man.
Yeah, Chef, the man you're bringing from Mobia, man.
Me know Vaseline.
Yeah, man. So big up the whole of Jamaica, Almanton, DJ Smurf, Mama Ellie's, Triple L Production, yeah, so many records.
Alright, sir.
DJ Kelsen,
yeah. Yeah, man, give thanks. Yes. Good day. Click it, man. Whatever I say, two dead sound feature. That's sweet, man. Ricky Chu, whatever I say, I got dead. That is so sweet, yes. Step in. Continent.
Yeah.
God, I'm stepping already, you know. I think both are stepping already, though. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Rasta.
Blessed man.
Yeah, man. Give thanks and praise. Well, I hope I have enough credit card to talk today. I've got $200 gone waiting. Anyhow, I don't know really what the title about the program tonight. When I wake up and hear they're talking about Cuba. You see what I say? See? But these things are not just today, you know, way back, you know what I mean? Because, check it, you know, them have a vote for there, and we don't check it out, Rasta. All the countries, them, vote for Cuba. And guess who don't vote for Cuba? America and Israel.
Yeah, but America, they create the embargo, you know, and the country, them, they have vote for make America stop it. So America never going to stop vote.
Yeah, I understand. So, may I tell you, I just today, so we could go on and talk a lot about from way back, the Lulumba, them King Lulumba, you know what I mean? But, you know, that's another really thing we want to talk about tonight. But the sadists say that, Rasta, you see the people, them, look, the fathers, them, you know, them protect them children in hand, you see, may I say, in a very special way. Teach them about our black history, our great black man who created a lot of things over the years. This is what I'm saying, Rasta. See, because right now in Jamaica, the teacher is saying, but what him don't know, that majority Jamaican can't spell what them talk, you know. I quiz them on the road many, many times, you know what I mean? Because if you sit down and know about Elijah McKay, you see me, I the great scientist who ever lived. You know, see, who was an engineer, African American, who was an engineer. I think he was in the industrial machine world. Listen, I say, I think at Detroit he come from. You know, I think he invented the drip cup for the island factory.
All right, him credit gone, you know. Yes, as him just said, yes.
Now my credit done, you know.
No, you don't. You already know. You ready for talk to you the way I say.
Yes, actually, I never come from, you know.
All right, listen, man.
And you are one now. This is the cutting edge, right?
Yeah, oh, man. Yeah, yeah man, at the cutting edge. Me, I listen to you, man.
Listen now. You know what, sir? Me, a Chilani man, and you come here and cut that movie with I and I. Me rate you still, you know.
Sankofa.
Me like, oh, you the big up the crowd and everything, and everybody internationally, worldwide, that deal with Muta, you know.
Mm.
But watch you know, road boy. You come here, sir, you cut the movie, you know.
Who cut the movie?
Yo, because you're the only man that no. Have the gun in the movie.
They don't even cut the movie. Me don't understand.
You don't make a film, rude boy.
No, me not, we are the one that don't call me no rude boy, man.
Fool
me
in
make...
Paradise.
Eh?
Fool in Paradise.
What name, sir?
And you're a movie.
Fool in Paradise?
Yes. You come and chill and come make the movie, right?
Hold on. A one movie. Wait, now, make I explain something to you. Me never make no movie. Me I get employed for acting in a movie.
Yo, you're not for yield. You're not for go so high, you know.
Yeah, but...
You
see, no, we not...
Eric Bingy.
No, but listen to me, man. The movie no name, no paradise, man. The movie name Sankofa.
I'm in paradise to the movie, the name.
But you know, listen to me, I say. Me say no movie, no, me no acting in a movie name, fooling apart. The movie name Sankofa.
What? Sankofa?
The movie name Sankofa. The one where me acting now. Me never make no movie in a Trelawney. Me acting a movie where shoot in a Trelawney. Me no make movie, Bridget.
Mota.
Yeah. Anyway, what you want about it? What you want about it? Tell me come a Trelawney, come make a movie and what?
Me want you come back down here now.
For do what?
Represent for whosoever they stand up in the movie.
What is this man, your man?
Watch out, don't cut me after me know you're
going to. Me not cut you, but me not cut you. Bridget, me tell me not make no movie. The people that move, no, make the movie.
You know what me at that,
who this, which you, man now move?
Eh?
Which man you say now move right?
The youth who, like, him can know how to fit in the ass, you know. Real ass, you know.
Yeah.
Your daughter would and the...
Yeah, me understand what you're saying. Yeah, me understand what you're saying. Yeah.
All right.
Then, oh, you're saying that the movie, where the
we can't reason.
Yeah, but me, I reason with you now. Wait, no, oh, you say right. You did in the movie, and you're telling me about me come movie.
Then if you did,
but if you did there, you'll know, son of me, make the movie. If you did there, oh, you know, son of me.
Listen to me.
Yeah.
You see, you are the only man me see have a gun in the movie. You know, me a little boy them time.
A liar tell man. The slave master, them did have gun in there.
You know what they are treating me rash.
Then the slave master, them never did have gun in the movie. You never see the brother hold up a gun and point that at me. You never see the slave master, them sit down.
Yes, that's
you know what I mean? I'm going to be the only man in there have gun.
Yo, you did have gun too.
But you don't tell me, I'm me alone in the movie have gun.
Alright.
You just tell me, see, I'm here loading at the movie.
We're not disclose that because.
What mean, not? They know what movie I'm holding for people, see, man.
The movie name Fool in Paradise.
The movie name Sankofa. Hey, wait a stop talking foolishly. The movie name Sankofa.
Sankofa.
Sankofa. Sankofa. And I'm fooling in Paradise. I'm fool talk, you talk. Who tell you that? Who tell you the movie name Fool? Oh, you say you're in the movie, I don't know what the movie name.
Well, I'm the man, me did dead.
No, you say you're in the movie. You say you're in the movie.
Rasta went dead, you know.
Where me I keep up the conversation?
Rasta went dead, you know. And a Rasta stay so boom.
I want you for Rasta did that.
Part.
Where they?
In the movie.
Yeah, and what?
And you say, yo, you me? Know what?
Yeah, what?
Give any what? Any old. A man can't fit this part here. Make go something there. Give it.
The brother, you're a big liar, you know.
Well, I'm a rat,
Motor.
No, you yeah, want big lie. I don't know. You say, you tell lie. You lie.
You remember? Motor.
Bridging. Watch out. I have to move. Where did that brother? Where did him come from? The man said, in the movie. Him say, me one have gone in the movie. You see, the part of me have the gun is a musket. You have some other people around behind me with the gun, you know. The slave master up on top of the hill have a gun, you know. The one of the slave them, a pint gun at me, you know. All of the slave master them have gone in the movie. And then them say him in the movie. And it name, where him say the movie name? Something like that, Paradise. Oh, where the man they come from, Rasta? Sure. Come disturb up the vibes, that's what I know, you know. The movie name Sankofa. And we did come to Trelawney, come show it. Some American when it Akinite come down at Trelawney, them invite me down there, them show it in the craft market. A week long I show it in the craft market. Me remember this thing to say them invite me come down there. Me never make no movie. Me not have nothing to do with the movie more than the Ethiopian ask me to play a part in the movie. I'm gonna play a part of the movie. The other day me get one copy and me get one of the sisters, the one we're pregnant. Where them beat to death in the movie. She's a security guard. I don't remember what she name. I see her at some fest one night. And how are them people? It's so people do people things, you know. Because you see now, him not get the money, him not know nobody will get the money in a fight. Him not see the movie. So I'm gonna tell people, see a mutter come down and come make the movie. So a mutter who all of them people that will not get no pay, you know. Yes, all the people that we see the movie there. Oh, you find it?
YouTube.
Is it on YouTube?
Peace, just 4 minutes.
Oh, yeah, 4 minutes. Right. Sankofa. You can't find things, Ibrahim. The man find the movie. They don't see me find it. They don't see me in it. Anyway, what me I say is that as some man, some people do people things. Because when a man hear him and say, no, me, come down there, come make movie. Name what? Something like that, Paradise. And me tell man say, oh, for coming at the movie, I don't know for coming at the movie, like that me at the owner, me at the director and thing. A man ever say, boy, I'm out come here to come make movie with man and not pay nobody. It's a wicked rasta man that. You understand? I saw them thing they go, you know. Pay wrong information and bodies, a lie my tell for me, you know. Lie my tell for me. And him securing and lie, you know. Yeah, man, him securing and lie, man. Anyway. Alright, sir. You find the movie, though. Believe you me. Yes. Cutting edge.
Yeah, Mota.
Yes.
Yeah, man. Mr. Same kind of stuff. The vibe.
The man must anyway, have get some you know. Bad rosemary. He must smoke too much bad rosemary. Don't have to learn it there.
You see, if I'm going to talk about still, because I tell you, say, it's just like with DJ Kev, I say, you see the amount of views what you have on the YouTube. If they need that chip in a dollar to move
to me never, I know, watch out. A Brian, sit down here so no one make me aware of where they on the YouTube, you know. I'm here people that are on YouTube because they go on YouTube.
They can't rename it.
Eh? YouTube.
They can't rename it to Motor Tube.
Ah, cutting razor.
Cutting razor.
Watch out. The man I watch the movie on TV. The man I watch all the Sankofa there. What him does that show me say 4 minutes at the Sankofa there, then I'm not seeing it. As we speak.
Give thanks there.
That means that people can look upon it at them own ledger, listen to it at them own ledger.
Listen to everything from more than 20 years ago, people can't find that. You see that?
All right, sir.
Yeah, that's just showing the legendary status for your half, you know?
Yeah, and the movie was 20 years ago.
We have a question. We know, the government people, they did free up this brother, Kern Spencer, you know? And it's like, we did all see that that's going to happen. But they never really said on that about the money. All the money go. You free up the man, but you don't get back the money. All that go. They never said nothing about that.
Them brethren, you know, she said, them pay $4 million for saying a man go and pay. They think, say, oh, a money them spend, you know? They know, she said, them don't spend.
It's a straight extortionist.
They just buy a place in a Trelawney for 100 odd million. And say, them going to spend another 100 odd million dollars on it. For do what? That place that they lose money from it make.
have to show you all them dangerous. It's like them have we in a system where them say, you're not supposed to ask no question. Mm-mm. Not ask with nothing, when I have nothing to tell you, tell you. And I don't know nothing about it.
Terrible.
You know? You see what happened at Burkina Faso last week?
Yeah, man. What do you mean you see what happened?
Yeah, tell us. Something like that need to rise up in a yard. But it's like, if we find out where it's going to start from, or where the trigger that off, it's like, you can't know,
just like in Egypt, so, you know, the thing just rise up, so you can't know it's going to start. But you know it's going to start.
And you see, it has to start, because you know what? We have to continue to keep going downhill. The youth, them all continue to kill them friends.
Yeah.
And it's like, we are just continue to destroy ourselves. It's like, it can't continue like how it has gone.
Mm-hmm.
And the government, them, they need to start listening to the voices of the youth, because if they don't start listening, some things are going to change up. Because when you check it out, look on the university, them, look, even the youth, nice students right now, we must have tertiary education. So
yeah.
What?
Yeah.
You know? But if you never create that thing with a youth the other day, how much time breeding them have a job? How much time breeding them have a job? Enough for you, them just left the school, them have borrowed money, go to the school, left the school. Can't do nothing. 5 years after that, they don't remember nothing. Them head gone back to blank. Mm. And government still has said, we are doing good in our. They're doing good in destroying the people.
Yeah.
Continuously.
Yeah.
So, me, I can't tell a man, I advise a man. You see, if a man can find a way out of this, it's probably the best thing that for him. You know?
You mean out of Jamaica? You
can find better out of this.
Okay.
Because that's what it's just a two type of prison there. You have one where you have some security man out there watching, and you live in a one, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Two gates and one gate there, up a town there, out of normal man the airport, and next one down at Santa airport there. Two gates that. So if you can't make it through them two gates there, you have to stay in that the prison there. And you can't move. And you just continue to just bury down yourself, oppressed every day. Nobody can get nothing for work, I have. You try everything, no matter how much money you have, it has got done. People used to drive them big vehicles 5-10 years ago. Right now, I buy them and look for them things there.
Yeah.
But they want to get rid of them. Government has sucked out everything. You can't ask no question. Nobody not supposed to ask nothing. So a man has to really get wise and know. Say,
all right, we're going to move now, Virgin, because you're going back for the same reason. I know. We're going to move.
Yes, sir.
Blessed, yeah? Give thanks. Yes. 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 Cutting edge. Oh, them gone, so. All right. So. the man, they just have set me up a while ago. I can't believe that the youth has set me up every year, you know. Click that. Yes. Cutting edge.
Yeah, man. Good night, Muta.
Good night, sir.
Well, I mean, it's not really a radio man, you know, and I just wake up and have the radio on Irie and hear the Irie thing. And so since recent, I've been listening to Irie.
Which part you start here from?
The documentary on the money.
Oh, money, yes.
Yeah, which kind of grabbed my attention.
Yeah, man.
And,
you know, since
Sunday morning, too, I listened to this sister in Kabul.
Yeah, me and I did that.
One morning, where she was contemplating about what is happening with the Chinese, them, or them giving the ruin river land.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but what maybe she not understand, what maybe she not really get to yet in it, is that one of the things the Chinese them is going after is water, because water is going to be the biggest traded commodity on the planet in the next 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people don't really understand that.
So
but I just quickly want to say something to you still.
Mm-hmm.
That in recent times, our Jamaican politicians, they have been doing what you call misdirection, which is a magician's trick. What them do is to shift your attention, the people's attention. It's like what them do with the smoking thing.
Yes.
And shift everybody's attention because Jamaica's like controversy.
Mm-hmm.
And when them shift your attention and everybody is doing that, something else slide under the carpet.
Mm-hmm. For example, that, give me an example.
All right, that is even the same thing with what going on with the Chinese them on the land, whereby what first it was the smoking thing where them just hurriedly bam 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 and put it out, you know, refine them, now them just do it quick and do it from an innocent a ministry that is so innocent. Ministry of Health. They look like them acting in your interest. The same time while deals are being cut, and yes, boy, them got China, and you hear that the deal is basically settled for the island out there, the sea, whatever they make
island,
up.
Goat Island thing.
Mm. And basically, and come back and say, okay, oh, we're going to Nepal and this and that to get approval. But the thing was already cut and done.
Mm.
And things like these. And okay, what them do is to shift your attention so that from people not paying much attention to that, and everybody is arguing over this issue. Well, behind it, there is something bigger going on.
Yeah, well, you know, say, every week something happening in Jamaica that it carry keep up again.
Well, it's several times that them try to do it, you know, but people not aware of it, you know.
Mm.
First, it was the smoking issue, then, like the ganja thing, they was trying to ride that, but that not seem to get no traction. So, and then keep using these issues and controversial issues to redirect the people, the nation's attention. I don't want to stay too long for the phone. I know you have more people waiting.
No, the program I got done, you know. It's not that the program I got wait. It's like the program I got done, you know.
No. Yeah, but it's really a blessing still. Yeah, that thing they say shadows to and it's money.
Shadows money, yeah. Yeah, man.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind if I could get a copy of
you
something.
You can't
like
get
that,
it by YouTube, man. You know, everybody go on YouTube, right?
YouTube. YouTube.
Yeah, but I'll send it to you.
Okay, so Shadows 2 come like this, and Shadows 1 too.
Yeah, me did play the Shadow 1 already.
No, you can't wake up about the 2 meek.
No. Me played years ago, but why me...
Oh, years? Okay, but why me play
the... Yeah, why me play the Shadows 2 is of two things. One, when we are going now with the International Monetary Fund.
Yeah, because
money.
It speak volumes to what is happening
now. That's
because
why we play that one. That's why we play that one. No, that's why we play that one. Because it very right now ish. You know, it right now.
It's relevant. Land.
Yeah. All right. Give thanks, Benjamin.
Yeah, man. Respect.
Yeah, we are tell you. yeah. Poem. Once I give thanks to the moment, give thanks to the time and the energy. You know, so we will be here again from 2 to 5:45 with the Stepping Razor.